Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah al-Aliyyil Azim. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Sallallahu ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa alihi al-Tayyibin al-Tahirin.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad Muhammad.
Allahumma akhrijni min dhulumat al-wahm wa akrimni bi nur al-fahm. Allahumma aftah alayna abwaab rahmatik wa anshur alayna khazana ulumik bi rahmatika ya arhamar rahim. After giving different definitions of adl or justice, now Ayatollah Motahari raises a few questions or objections that people may have with respect to divine justice. One question is, so these are the questions that inshallah will be clarified gradually. One question is, why there is so much discrimination or difference in the world? There are two issues: discrimination and difference. Difference, like for example, we have different colors, we have different gender. Discrimination in the sense that, for example, someone is beautiful, someone is not beautiful. Someone is a human being, there are animals, there are other types of beings. Some are angels, some are shaitan, you know, so there are differences and there is discrimination. Of course, this is the question, but we will inshallah clarify. The second issue is, why when some beings are created, then they cease to exist? Why there is destruction? Or why there is death? For the people who think death is ceasing to exist. So this question is, if something is created, is given existence, why this existence is taken away? Why you create human beings and then taking their lives? Okay? It's a question. The reason this question is asked is that people think, some people, that as long as you have not created, they don't have any right over you. But if you create them, then you cannot just destroy them or, you know, take their existence away from them. The other question is about limitations and problems. Like, there is ignorance, there is weakness, there is illness, there is poverty. Why? Why in the world we have such things? The other question is, why there are calamities? There are microbes, there are germs, or injustice, theft, earthquake, flood, storm, wars, conflicts. Why there is shaitan? Why there is temptation from nafs ammare, these type of problems? And then Ayatollah Motahari says, this question can be turned into a kind of theological and philosophical question and say, why things which are not useful are created? Why things which are harmful are created? If God is just and wise, only good things should be created. And this leads us to a very important question that we will discuss in more details, inshallah, soon. The question of having two creators, in the world. One for creating good things, one for creating bad things. There have been people that they had the idea that God has only created good things and bad things are created by devil, for example. So this quickly leads to that question. If we cannot explain properly why we have such problems in the world, some people may say, okay, we have another creator for them. Or some people may even deny existence of God, as some people have done. Then Ayatollah Motahari has a discussion about why justice, divine justice, has been taken as one of the principles of, you know, religion or mazhab. Sometimes we say Usul al-Din are five, and we mention Adl as one of them. Sometimes we say Usul al-Din are three, and Usul al-Mazhab are five, depending on how you, you know, articulate. In any case, for us Shia, divine justice is one of our principles of faith. Why? Salaam alaikum. He mentions two reasons. One reason is a very important point about this issue of justice. This is one of those issues in theology that does not remain only among the theologians. Now, there are many issues in theology and especially in philosophy that only scholars discuss. There might be controversies, debates, differences of opinions, but only theologians know about it. But this issue of divine justice and problems that, you know, exist in the world is something that scholars and lay people, everyone talks about it. Because people face this problem, you know, illness, death, injustice, earthquakes, a storm, flood. People see these problems, and if they cannot understand why, then they may lose their faith, or they may face, may be affected. So this is why we have not put in Usul al-Din many theological issues, but we have put Adl Ilahi, divine justice, as one of the principles. But in addition to this, there's a historical reason. This is something about the significance of this issue, but there is also a historical reason, which we have mentioned in some other books, you know, that in early Islam, a debate started about divine justice. And that was not because some Muslims didn't accept divine justice. That was because the way Muslims understood divine justice was different. And that was based on a more underlying question. And that was about understanding goodness and badness, whether goodness and badness are essential or not, whether they are rational or religious. Usnuqoh-e zati, usnuqoh-e arazi. Zati means essential, intrinsic goodness and badness. Arazi means accidental. And also, if we accept usnuqoh-e zati, intrinsic goodness and badness, then we can talk about whether we can understand it rationally or not. But if you say there is no such a thing as intrinsic goodness and badness, objective goodness and badness, then there is no way to talk about reason being able to understand. So this debate was there. Then the debate about free will and determinism, predestination. So these questions led to some people saying, like Ash'arites, that God is just by definition. God is just because justice is what he does or what he asks us to do. It doesn't help you to understand anything about what type of things he does or he says, you know? Whatever he says is good. Whatever he does is good. But the Shiites and Mu'tazilites had the idea that yes, whatever he says or does is good, is just, but not by definition. It's a real issue. It's an objective issue. He considers standards, requirements, criteria for goodness and badness, and all his commands are in compliance with those standards. So if God says you must be just, you must be benevolent, and Allah ya'mur bil adl wal ihsan, because in reality these two things are different from their opposites. Even if you had no religion, no faith, you should be able to understand that justice is better than injustice. Benevolence is better than wronging people. In any case, as we said before in some other books, and inshallah we also mentioned later, this was a very important debate which still continues and even existed in Christianity, in Judaism, in among Greek philosophers. So one historical reason for Shia stressing on divine justice as one of their principles is because they wanted to take a position, a stance in this debate. But as I said, there is another reason which is related, and that is, this is an issue that every person, whether a theologian or a scholar or layperson, discusses and is concerned about it. So we have to treat it as a matter of priority. The next issue is adl and hikmah, justice and wisdom. Among attributes of God, we have chosen justice as a principle. Yeah. So for example, power of God is not one of our principles, although we believe in power of God. Knowledge of God is not one of our principles. It is justice. But there is very close connection between justice and hikmah. And we need to talk about this relation. What is justice? What is hikmah? Some of the questions actually might relate to hikmah, not justice. You remember when we are discussing aqaid, whether it be Islamic belief system or theological instructions, I told you that actually people cannot that much question justice of God in the theological sense, because they don't have any right over God. They cannot say God has done injustice to us. It's like God giving from his own money to people. If someone from his own pocket gives money to people, he doesn't need to observe, you know, equality or any criteria, if it's a matter of justice. But then it's a matter of wisdom, that as a wise person, why you didn't give someone and gave the one next to it, next to him? Or why you gave them different amounts? It's a issue of wisdom. You remember we had this in Aqaid. So these two qualities, adl and hikmat, justice and wisdom, are very closely connected. Adl, in one definition, as we said, is to give everyone and everything what they deserve. Okay? But wisdom is to create the best, the most beautiful, the most endurable thing. This is wisdom. Because wise person is the one who does things for reason. Please, there is this point is not here in the book. Listen, I explain it for you. Why wisdom requires to do the best. Can you understand why wise person should do the best? You know, we say Nizam Ahsan, the best system, the most beautiful system has to be created by God. Why?
Inherently he's wise.
Pardon?
Inherently he's wise himself.
Yes. No, but why someone who is wise has to do the best? Yes.
If he doesn't do the best, then he's doing zon.
Why?
Because he's
I can, for example, I can make the best. I can make the best house. I can make the second best house, the third best house. Why I should make the first?
Due to his status and caliber, that if he doesn't do it, it is qabih for him.
Why?
Because he is capable of better, and he chose to do the lesser good, or the, you know, put the mafdul instead of the afdal.
So what is the problem? Let's first him and then yes.
I think maybe the question would be, why did he do the second or the third best? There would be too many questions about all the other ones.
Yes.
He didn't do the best thing. The best thing is pretty obvious.
Yes, this is one point. Yes, Abu Jafar.
And use the intellect in the best way.
Why I should use my intellect in the best way? Why it is not enough to use it in a good way? Yes.
I think the wise person usually count the consequences as well.
Okay.
So therefore, when he does something, consequentially, it should be, or if you say that if this should be, for example, should stay for longer time, the house, for example, should be cheap, not too expensive, for example, should be solid, should be, good place for living, such things.
Comfort. So you don't need to do the best. Sometimes you may not do the best because, for example, you see, it's not needed to spend this much.
Maybe it's not necessarily this much. Maybe you are wise without spending that much.
You want to say?
Yeah, I just want to say that it's like husn kub akli. So because wisdom is the peak of akl, and it's the demand of the akl to create the best.
Why? So, this is the question. Why akl says you have to do the best? Yes.
There is a manifestation of God's love for his creation. Thus he wants to give us the very best. Because he loves us.
Why
so
you
much.
Cannot just give enough? Why you have to give the best?
Because he loves us so much.
Because Allah has given.
If you love someone, do you need to make the best food or a very good food?
I think the best food.
Why?
I'll give the best food to the person.
Because it will be against his adl. It will be against the adl.
Father?
Yes. How you carry out the task.
Okay.
It might be obvious, but if you're wise, you know what's best. And then once you know what's best, it just doesn't make sense not to do it if you're wise. So it's sort of like a cycle.
Maybe you think it's not necessary.
Then that goes back to wisdom. If in a certain case it's not necessary to do that best, but then it wouldn't be best anymore. Because if it's best, that means it is necessary. It is the
best necessary option.
Your wisdom
will
tell you what's best, and
knowing
that it's best and you're wise, you will do it.
Yes. Thank you. Yeah, he was, I think, first. You
want
to say something?
Allah has given wisdom not to everybody.
Yeah.
There's very few people who has got the wisdom. Yeah. That's why they've been advised to use it at perfect way.
Why?
Yeah. Okay, last. It was before it.
Shekhna, I think intrinsically, if someone is wise, naturally, because they are wise, they will choose the best. If the second, third, and the fourth are, let's say, without a rajah, there's no. How should we say in English?
Without preference.
If there's no preference, otherwise, like it's not more difficult or unachievable, and between the best option and all the second options and the third options and so on, because goodness in itself has value, and the wise person, because they are wise, intrinsically realizes this, they would select the best because it is in their nature to do that.
Why it's in the nature? The question is why. You wanted to say something? And then you are the last. Yeah.
The thing is, it's not about the best at what I can do. It's to do the best in that situation. The situation demands the best. So it might not necessarily be my best, but it might be best for the situation or the person that is needing what is needed.
Yeah.
So that kind of.
So why you should do the best for that situation?
So otherwise, I wouldn't be considered wise.
Why? You do something which is good.
No.
But why you should do the best? If you want to be more economical,
no, I want the best for that person because Allah has
a perfect. No, seriously, because some people say one of the principles of rationality is to do just what is enough. Don't do more.
Allah has given us more than enough in any case. We can't even count. So He's always done that.
So we want to understand why.
He has unlimited everything.
Why is it necessary? Maybe you can say out of his favor. But what we want to say, because if you say that's a requirement of wisdom, then you can question someone's wisdom if he doesn't do the best. Okay?
But okay, you can question my wisdom or any other person's wisdom, but how can you question somebody who's already perfect and the most wise? Why would you question that to be?
No, I'm just trying to understand why a wise has to do the best.
I'm just trying to give the arguments.
Yes.
I mean, the thing is, because that being is so wise and perfect, and it's in his nature to do the best for that particular creation. So
why? Why is it in their nature to do the best? You are putting the answer gradually in the question.
Mm-hmm. Why not? We give up, Sheikh. Can you answer?
Yes.
I'm saying if someone has an intention, you have the knowledge of all ways of fulfilling the intention and the power to choose any of those options, why would you choose anything except the most perfect one?
Yeah, so this is a way of answering, but this is just enough to say, I don't know why he should not do something else. It doesn't prove that he must do the best. You can say, I don't see why. Yes.
He has the most perfect knowledge.
Yeah.
He is the most merciful.
Yeah.
So
both these combined, he has
to
be
the best. And he's perfect himself, so his
acts
should be the best.
Yeah. Yes, this is also a good way of explaining. So, I think
can you answer?
More or less, everyone understands, but maybe how to say. So, one answer is what was said, that the best is always one. But if you want to not to have the best, then there is no endless question. It can be the second, it can be the third, it can be the fourth. There is no preference. You know, the best is like a straight line between two points. That is only one. But there can be many lines which are not straight. So, for the wise to do something which is not the best needs extra reason than doing. But doing the best needs just reason for doing. In addition to this, we can say, as the sister said, if wise is perfect, is something. If wise is imperfect, is another thing. When wise is perfect, not only wisdom gets into the decision, but also perfection gets into the decision. So what he does should reflect his wisdom and his perfection. Therefore, it has to be the best, the perfect choice. Is that for people like us, that we have limited power, limited time, limited resources, limited knowledge, we don't need to do the best necessarily. We can do the best within our comfort or within, for example, you know, our limits. Because if for everything that we do, we want to do the best, it would not work. You know, like people who are perfectionists. Those who are perfectionists, they try to do everything perfect, but it ends up with not being able to do many things. Yeah? Like, for example, if you are a perfectionist in washing your kitchen, then from morning till night, you are just washing. Okay? If you are a perfectionist, for example, in writing, you write, then you say it's not good. You write again. You write again. You know, 100 times you start and you never finish. But for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to do things in the best way, or second best way, or third best way, doesn't cost anything. It's not it's more difficult, it's not that it takes his time more, it reduces his treasures. There is no explanation why someone who can do the best as easy as doing the second best, why he should do the second or the third. So it's not only a matter of wisdom, it's also a matter of, again, wisdom with absolute knowledge and power and resources that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has. So he has created the best system. But, inshallah, we will explain more in the future, but this is one of the key points that you should remember all the time. This is the best possible system. The best possible. For example, you give me 100 square meter land, and you tell me, make the best home for me. Okay, I will try to make the best home for you, but the best home in 100 square meters. Don't ask me, you know, to make a palace in 100 square meters. In the physical, material world, we cannot have perfect beings. We cannot have perfect situation. There can be limitations, there can be shortages, there can be conflicts, there can be competition. Yeah? Imagine if all people of the world wanted to live in the most beautiful place in the world. It was not possible. Or if there is a river, if everyone wanted to make his farm next to the river, it's not possible. There's limitation. Or for example, if I am not driving carefully, I can hit you. Because in this world, not only what you do counts, what others do also counts. Yeah? In heaven, you would not be affected by bad people or careless behavior of other people. But in dunya, careless behavior of bad other people or bad behavior can affect you. So, this is the best system, but remember, this is the best possible system. And there is no way for Allah to make the second best, the third best, or just good system. No, this is the best possible system. So, the question then is how we can make sense of some of the problems. Yes.
Sheikh, can we say that this is the best possible system for the purpose that it was created for? Because, for example, we can say, okay, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also created the hereafter, the heaven, and that could have been what we have. But the purpose for that is different than the purpose we have here. So for this purpose that we are here, this is the best system that we have?
Yeah, it's the best possible world, and at the same time is the best for our purpose. Because actually, all the limits that are in this world are good for us. Because we want situation for testing people. Yeah? If we were not affected by each other's behavior, then how we were tested?
Mm.
If we were not affected by shortage of, for example, food or rain, or resources, then how we were tested. So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us in the physical, material world and gave us free will. And this is actually we need. If we were created in heaven, then we could not gain what we can gain from dunya. Yeah. In heaven, you cannot become a mu'min in contrast to kafir. Or a patient person, grateful person, in contrast to someone who is impatient or not grateful. So it's true, yes, that for the purpose that we have, this is the type of world that we need. And that is the best. So, we have justice, which means to give everything and everyone what they deserve. And we have wisdom, which means to create and to do the best, the most beautiful. To have a purpose, and for that purpose you do the best. Wisdom of God is one of the results of knowledge of God. And one of the results of God's quality of muridiyya, God is willing. Because you remember in Kalam, we had this discussion that God is murid and kare. He likes certain things and he doesn't like certain things. He decides to do certain things and he doesn't decide. It's not that everything that he can do, he would do. Yeah, God is not like a robot or like a machine that whatever can do, would do it. God can do many, many things and can stop doing many, many things. Among endless choices that he has, he chooses some of them and wills them and does them. So, wisdom of God is directly related to his knowledge plus his irada. So what he knows to be the best, he decides, he wills to do. But Ayatollah Motahari says, justice of God is not directly related to his knowledge and his will. It is one of the qualities of action and not a quality of essence. It's a quality of action. Then he says one of the things that has been discussed is the issue that I just mentioned and I said we will talk about it later. Thanawiyat, a kind of dualism. You know, dualism has many meanings. And in philosophy has been used in different sense. For example, dualism of soul and body. But one of the meanings of dualism is that we have two types of creation. As if there is a partition. One God who created all the good things, and one God who created bad things. You may not call him God, but any name, the creator. For example, according to some interpretations, it is said that Zoroastrians had this idea, and maybe still have this. But of course, many Zoroastrians today say that we are monotheist. And Ayatollah Motahari says in Avesta, which is their book also, there are places that match Tawheed. In some places, it's not clear. Although Islamically, we can prove that they are Ahlul Kitab. And they had a book from God, and they had a prophet. So in origin, definitely monotheistic. Today, there are different opinions, but if they say we are monotheist, so we should accept. Anyway, there was this idea that there is Ahura Mazda and Ahriman. Ahura Mazda is God, who creates good things, beautiful things. Ahriman is the devil that creates bad things. And they wanted in this way to defend God by saying that God is not doing bad things. Bad things are done by
someone else.
So this is the issue of Thanabiyat. He says, in ancient Iran, this idea was popular. And they had this idea, and he says, very ancient, Iranians, when they came to this place, one of the ideas that they had was this, that there is a kind of separation. Rain, sunshine, good things come from one source, and illness and death and poverty come from and Zartosht, he says, was not able to eradicate this from minds of Iranians. Some Iranians. Zoroastrian, the prophet of the Zoroastrians. So he was not able to eradicate, even if we believe that he was a prophet and they had a book, but this was not completely eradicated. And even after that, there were other religions in Iran. They had also some traces of this. Till Islam came. And Islam totally stopped any kind of shirk. Even there were people who believed in a kind of dualism, but for example, they said we should only worship one God, but there are two creators. So they didn't have Tawheed in Khaliqiyya, but they had Tawheed in Ubudiyya. Okay? But there were people who said no, we should also worship bad God. Because otherwise he gets angry with us, we should do something to please also bad, God. But some people said, no, we only worship one God. But there are also bad things that are created by someone else. But in Islam, we have Tawheed in all dimensions. Tawheed, Fizzat, Fizzifat, Fil-Af'al, Fil-Khaliqiyya, Fil-Ubudiyya, in every aspect. And then he says, after Islam, this idea disappeared in Iran. He quotes this beautiful ayah in the Quran from Surah An'am, that in the discussion about Nur, we mentioned this in the lectures on Nur. Alhamdulillah alladhi khalaqa as-samawati wal-ard. وَجَعْلَ الظُّلُمَاتِ وَالْنُورِ He has created the skies and the earth, and he has made light and darkness. It's not that light is created by someone and darkness by someone else. Of course, light is created, darkness is not created.
Yes, of light.
And this is why I said ja'ala al-dhulumat, not khalaqa al-dhulumat wal-nur. Yeah? Made darkness and light, because darkness is lack of light. So, not only, he makes a very beautiful point here. He says, not only Islam put an end to the idea that bad things are created by someone else, Islam also clarified for people that nothing bad is created. It's relative. Okay? رَبُّنَا الَّذِي أَعْطَى كُلَّ شَيْءٍ خَلْقَهُ ثُمَّ هَدَى. When Fir'aun asked Musa and Harun, مَنْ رَبُّكُمَا يَا مُوسَى? The answer was, our Lord is the one that gave everything. كُلَّ شَيْءٍ. كُلَّ شَيْءٍ includes everything. Not that good things only. Everything. Yes, we believe everything is good. That's another issue. But we don't accept that God created some of the things. God created everything. If you have problem in understanding why bad things are there, then you have to correct your understanding about what is bad. Yes.
How do we understand Ja'al al-Dhulumati wa Nur? So Nur here is also Ja'al or
yes.
Creation?
Ja'al is Amma's creation. Ja'al means to make. Make can be by creating or can be by
attribution.
By a kind of, like for example, I can say God made shadow. But if I say God created shadow, is not very accurate, because shadow is not created. You know, shadow is when something does not let light come, then we have shadow. But shadow is not a real thing. Shadow is lack of light. Indeed, around that shadow, there is light. There is no light here, we call it shadow. Like, for example, dryness. Dryness is not created. When there is no humidity, we say it's dry. Otherwise, not that dryness is created. Okay? So, he says, Iranians, after Islam, not only they didn't believe in a second creator for bad things, but in a mystical view, they came to this conclusion that nothing bad is in the world. Ghazali says, لَيْسَ فِي الْإِمْكَانِ أَبْدَعُ مِمَّا كَانَ لَيْسَ فِي الْإِمْكَانِ أَبْدَعُ مِمَّا كَانَ. In the world of contingency, there is nothing more beautiful than what it actually exists. So among different possible worlds that God could have created, this is the best. Okay? And then he continues with this discussion and to what Hafez, who is a very well-known Iranian poet, says. He says, پیر ما گفت خطا بر قلم صنع نرفت. پیر ما means our
my teacher
or master, the one that is our spiritual mentor, said خطا بر قلم صنع نرفت. The pen of creation. If you imagine everything which is created is written by a pen. So the pen of creation didn't make any mistake. آفرین بر نظر پاک خطا پوشش باد. He says, well done, or
خوشحال با, or bravo.
Bravo.
Bravo to
his pure vision. that was able to cover problems. Our Sheikh said, nothing mistaken or nothing bad is created, but he says, this is because he had the vision to see everything beautiful. You know? Because it's a matter of understanding. If you don't have good understanding, you would see even good things bad. If you have understanding, even bad things that people think they are bad, you see them as good. Yeah.
How do you see murder as good?
Pardon?
How do you see murder and rape as good?
If you just look at this issue, you say it's bad. Mm-hmm. But is it bad that people have free will? Is it bad that there is gender, there is sexual desire? If you look at all these things, you see this is good. The only bad thing that has happened by that person who has done this crime is misuse of good things. But even this misuse in the system is better to have the possibility of it than making everyone free without freedom. This is where bad exists, but you have to see good side in this bad. This is actually what Hafez wants to say. That he doesn't want to say these problems are good, but he says you have to have the vision and the sight that you see good things. You know, like for example, of course there are differences, but as an example, if there is a difficult exam, not, you know, very difficult, but exam has to be difficult if it is something that requires a studying and something that can tell you who has studied, who has not studied. If all students, regardless of their efforts, can pass the exam, that exam is useless. Yeah? An exam that all students pass is useless. An exam that all students fail is also useless. Yeah? We need an exam that some people pass and some people fail, but not by drawing a lot. By, you know, you say, what is Shiria Khat? What is English?
Flipping a coin.
Uh-huh. Something based on their efforts, on their hard work. Okay. Those students who have no vision, or they are very short-sighted, they say exam is bad. I wish there was no exam in a school. Yeah? Because it's difficult. But those who have vision, they say no, exam is good. I am suffering. Maybe now I have to, you know, reduce my sleeping. I cannot, you know, play. But exam is good. Okay? So, it's a matter of your understanding as well. So he said, Afarin bar nazar paake khata pooshash baad. So he praises his teacher, his master, that had this vision and sight that was pure and therefore was only seeing things in a pure way, and anything which was bad, he was able to overcome and go beyond and see beauty of it.
So Sheikh, when Zainab alayhi salam says Ma ra'aytullah jamila,
yes,
is she referring, for example, to the beauty that was achieved by Imam Hussein and his followers personally and for the Ummah and for the Islam in this respect?
What she says, of course, we are not 100% sure, you know, what we understand it, but I think what the lady meant was, I am not distracted by little bad things and bad people who are there. I am able to look at the whole and and the whole picture is beautiful. Indeed, maybe we can say Karbala is the most beautiful picture in the world. I don't think you can find any place more beautiful than Karbala, because this is where the greatest virtues that can normally remain hidden emerged. Okay? In the lecture I had about for Lady Zainab just this year, I said, if you want to show the beauties of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, it's not enough to look at Imam Hussein when he is praying or fasting or doing for Hajj, going for Hajj. Or even when he is doing, for example, Du'a Arafah. They are very beautiful. But nothing like Karbala showed those hidden virtues of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Because when you challenge someone, then that's the time to know him. And if you want to show how pure is someone, how virtuous, how kind, how generous is, challenge him, challenge him. Most of people, after a certain degree, fail. You know? Some people can fail very quickly. For example, their salary this month is stopped, they fail. They have to wait in queue, for example, under sun heat, they fail. They don't observe justice. But when people are ill, when people lose their loved ones, when the people are under attack. So that's the time to see the beauty of people. So add to the challenges. When you add to the challenges, then, if someone can remain pious and virtuous and hopeful, then you can realize that this person is 100% pure. Because if there was any purity, it was coming on the surface. So, Karbala was beautiful, and indeed was maybe the most beautiful thing that Lady Zainab saw in her life. Where you could see so many pure servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where you could see these lovers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all together in one place, that they didn't show any sign of weakness, any sign of impurity, any sign of attachment to dunya, any sign of ego. When you could see love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the maximum. So she saw something very beautiful. You could say, didn't Lady Zainab see those ugly people? Of course she saw those ugly people. But those ugly people were not able to divert her attention from understanding the whole picture. That's the main thing. So this is the view that we should get. If you don't have that view, even if you are given the best thing, you can always be unhappy. You know? If you give, for example, someone the most delicious food, he says, you know, there is a problem in this food, because then I have to go to the restroom. How about enjoy the food? So even if you... You know, some people, even we say in Farsi, if you give them even honey, they complain. Because they cannot see the beauty. But those who have vision, they can have an overall assessment, put everything together, and make a conclusion. So we have to correct our vision. Unfortunately, there are people, because they don't have that systematic view of the world, they question justice of God, wisdom of God, love of God. But if you have that picture, if you were yourself in the position of God, you would have not done something better than this. Now, because of lack of your knowledge, you think you could do better. You know, like people who have nor experience of, for example, you know, leadership. They think it's very easy. You come and few days you solve all the problems. But when you are given the position, you see it's not easy. It's very, very difficult. Yes.
World and the whole creation is the best possible creation.
Yes.
And overall, if we look at, for example, if, you know, having free will is better than not having free will, and certain clashes wouldn't happen. But can we not say that if someone says there are certain like places which doesn't really have to do anything with the limitations of the creation? For example, earthquake comes and, you know, this baby is right in the middle of, you know, this place where this crack is. You know, if this baby was, you know, somewhere else, this wouldn't, it's not the limitation, the baby is still baby, earthquake still happened, but it's just by, you know, Allah could have, you know, maybe made him be somewhere else instead of on that crack. Or,
okay,
you know, when it comes
did,
to...
Did Allah put him there, or, for example, parents put the baby there?
No, but he could have prevented it. Right.
Yeah, but he has created a system. If he wants to interfere, whenever we make a mistake, if he wants to interfere, then next time you become lazy. You say, you know, Allah is going to save my baby. You know, like religious people. Actually, we have become sometimes, you know, unfortunately, lazy. Because he helps us, then we don't try to improve. You say... Tawakkul, tawassul, ziyara, you know, we solve the problems. You know, this is why sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of His love for us, let us fail.
Indeed.
So that next time we do better.
Wow.
This is out of His love that you have to fail.
But teaching to the cost of, for example, letting someone, you know, die or someone to be, you know, as it was said, raped. Fine, don't take the free will away because you want to show how bad or how good people are.
Yeah.
But when the guy is like shooting someone, you know, make it such that he doesn't die. Why should he die? And he can, you know, he would have passed his test that he's failed, he's shot someone. And that person is still alive for his family and is around. So nothing changes in the world. This guy has his life and this person's been tested.
If there was no possibility of murder, many, many tests were not there.
Mm.
For example, imagine if we were, for example, able to drive, but we knew that no matter how we drive, no one is going to be killed. The whole system of everything will be upside down. Because either the rules of physics had to change, or every time mojaza had to happen.
What's the problem that every time mojaza happens?
Then there is no system. You know, imagine if you make a system that you have to always interfere. Then this is not a system. And we don't learn them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made a system that for those who don't want to see Him can actually stop seeing Him altogether. Because He has made a system. And those who want to see Him can see Him everywhere. But if he was interfering in everything, then no one could deny him. One of the important aspects of this is that he wants to give us the chance of denying him. So that then believing in him would be a credit. If he was himself every day getting into our life and, you know, doing all mu'jizah, then there was no value for iman. Yes, 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 it's the idea of test will be lost. And many, 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 many things can happen through these difficulties. You know, how you look after, for example, orphans, how you, you know, observe justice. Many, many things are because of this. Okay, inshallah, we continue this discussion next week. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين.